That was the policy and why they pulled over Tayon Lee in 2018. Mm-hmm. Supposedly to stop violent crime. But they pulled over an 18-year-old male who was doing absolutely nothing for an alleged Wyatt Turn, detained him for 45 minutes, and searched his vehicle. Talked to his mother as if she was not human, and said she was the problems, and bragged about how this was going to end up on Facebook and they were going to look like demons. It's racist. It's racial profiling. The Fourth Amendment right to be free of unlawful search and seizure, to be free from illegal search warrants, is just as important as the Second Amendment right that we hold so dear. LMPD forgot that. The officers forgot that. The city forgot that. And I say the city because it's gone so long with the officers not being held accountable. That's why we are here today. That's why Breonna Taylor, that's why Tamika cannot call her daughter. It's because behavior has gone unchecked. Sexual assault's not investigated. Sexual assault's by officers. This isn't just an LMPD problem. It's a city problem. It's prosecutors who have allowed police officers to present flimsy cases and push for plea bargains. It's prosecutors who have refused to hold criminal officers who engage in criminal behavior accountable. It's a city who has not complied. They said we have a civilian oversight review, but we hear they're still not turning over records to the oversight panel. So it's not just LMPD. And I'm glad, for one, that the Department of Justice is going to be here, that there is a consent decree, that there are going to be monitors making sure that we're not just talking lip service about reform this time, but we're actually getting reform.
Yeah, so surprise, surprise, we've got one of the worst police departments in the United States of America. And if we don't have the courage of Tayon Lee, of Tamika Palmer, of all the people that stood up and demanded change, then the Department of Justice doesn't just wake up one day and say, we're going to investigate this police department. So one thing that I'm confident in today is that we have a city full of people that are finally willing over the past few years to say enough is enough. Now, new administration, same problems, recommendations. This isn't the first time that we've heard them. We saw a Hilliard Heights report come out. We heard all about transparency. We've been hearing this stuff for years. So I think the true measure of where we're going to go as a city and the relationship with the police is where we stand over the next couple of years and what is going to be done to fix it. Now, I'm not here today for y'all to hear from me. I want you to be able to ask Tayon, Tamika, anything that you want to, because obviously this is a big day for them. It's a big day for us. I think that the city has a lot to be proud of today. I think there's probably some good police officers out there today that realize that maybe they're actually going to get to police with people that share like minds with them. Anybody who hasn't read the 86-page report needs to sit down, find the time to read it. There are certainly things that were in there that I'd never heard of, whether it came from sexual assault victims, teenagers that, you know, were beaten badly, people who had their homes raided with no probable cause, search warrants that were sealed, not so it could, you know, be a situation where it didn't compromise the integrity of an investigation, but because there was no probable cause. Traffic stop after traffic stop after traffic stop that went unrecorded and unreported. And these types of things don't happen unless it's absolutely systemic. We're not talking about a few rotten apples in a police department. We are talking about a culture of cover-up, of collusion. And finally, the Department of Justice puts together this report that essentially says, you guys have a crisis on your hands and you need to fix it. So let's see what they do with it. But we're thankful for a lot of people today, especially these two courageous souls right here.
Questions.
Tamika, could you talk about, I know there's been a lot of misinformation about the settlement. I see you have on your uniform, you went back to work because your patients missed you. Does this give you vindication you've been waiting for?
No, I mean, it's heartbreaking to know that everything you've been saying from day one has to be said again through this manner, you know, that it took this to even have somebody look into this department. It's a, I don't know.
General Berlin specifically talked about the Warren in Breonna's apartment. When you heard that today, what went through your mind? Because he essentially said that they shouldn't have been.
Heartbreak all over again, because I knew that to begin with. I said that from the very beginning. We've asked that question 100 times over and over for no one to ever give you a direct answer.
I hope the search warrant information that Merrick Garland and Deputy AG Kristen Clark discussed is really evaluated at the judicial level too, because those search warrants don't get signed without judges. And so you have to, as judges, and I'm going to challenge our judges, yes, this investigation was on the patterns of practice of the police department, but I'm going to challenge judges to look closer at search warrants. If you keep seeing the same language over and over, you have to dig more. Police officers aren't allowed to get to that point if you challenge them when they come to you for your signature. Judges have to sign police reports. Prosecutors, you have to be more involved in your cases. So while this is about LMPD, it's an indictment on the full criminal justice system in Louisville, Kentucky. Any other questions?
I was gonna say, that was easy.
What about the young man? Would you, have you been able to look at the press conference from earlier? Or
I did watch it.
What were your thoughts on that, and specifically hearing your name in the case?
You know, I'm glad that the DOJ, you know, spoke up and said what we've all been saying for years. You know, everything that the community knew, finally someone else investigated, you know, and exposed it all. Said it all, like I said, what we've all been knowing. So to finally have that behind you, you know, I like to see our future, you know, what the future looks like now for Louisville.
Were you ever in doubt that this day would come?
I think we all were in doubt that it would actually come, and we would be lying if we didn't say that. I mean, because think about it. Tayon's case happened in 2018. Breonna was murdered in 2020. The DOJ didn't begin investigating until 2021. We don't get here to this point today without the Department of Justice and their Division for Civil Rights. And so I think we would be lying if we said we saw us getting here. We hoped we would get here. But I was hopeful once the DOJ stepped in. But prior to that, we've seen our officers. It's business as usual to pull over 30 cars in one day that live in the West End and are driven by black males. Like, that's exactly what the officers told him. Like, oh, when we're done with you, we're going to go pull over 30 more people today. That's what our department was doing.
And again, do you think this speaks to the power of protest? Because for a while, after Breonna's death, people were mentioning it, but it wasn't getting any traction in terms of, like, the national coverage or local coverage.
It definitely speaks to the power of protest, because Sam and I have been in this fight for a long time. It didn't start with Tayon. It didn't start with Breonna Taylor. And so Louisville Metro has known about these problems for a very long time. But they chose to do nothing because the heat was not there. And so it's definitely the power of protest and the power of the people. And I always push, it's the power of voting and making sure that we're putting people in place who are going to fight for us. And that's local elections on up to the president's, because 2020, that the DOJ didn't kick off its investigation because that Department of Justice was not doing patterns and practice investigations. Even though they were needed, necessary, required. So elections matter.
Looking at the things that the DOJ wants LMPD to move forward with and do you all think it's enough to make change in metro government and LMPD?
Well, I didn't see in there that they need to get rid of everybody in upper command staff, and I didn't see anything in there that said that, you know, anybody that's been, they need to go back and retroactively hold accountable some of these officers that were doing some of these things that are absolutely terrible. So no, it's not enough. And I think one thing this department has shown is that they're not going to proactively go out. They may get on TV and say that they've done 150 different things, but you know, we were able to negotiate reform as part of the settlement in the Breonna Taylor case, and I don't think it's a secret that we're still fighting with them to try to get some of those reforms enacted. You know, I mean, there's an early intervention warning system that was supposed to go into play right away that we've had since 2013. Yet we read in this report today that thankfully the DOJ was able to identify that as of 2022, it had finally been put into play, but there were no parameters that they could actually identify. So, you know, I think that the true testament to the success of the DOJ's evaluation is yet to be seen, because we got to see in the future if all these things get implemented. And I think until you get out that old guard of power over there, and until you got somebody that comes in that's going to show, you know, through actions and not just words, that they're going to hold these officers accountable, that they're going to do the little things that the DOJ says, like sit down once a month, watch body camera footage of your officers to make sure that they're adhering to policies and procedures. Until we see that's actually happening, I mean, we can sit here and celebrate this day as we should, but I feel like we've gotten up and celebrated a few days where when we look back a few months later, we said, wow, well, you know, some things are happening on paper, but are they really being implemented? And Lenita hits it head on, you know, until we have a local authority that's going to have the courage and the willingness to stand up and prosecute these things, then these officers can go to bed at night knowing that maybe they'll get a slap on the wrist at their job, maybe they'll get in a little bit of trouble from a disciplinary standpoint, but that they're not going to be held accountable criminally. I mean, we just saw the Brian Bailey thing a couple weeks ago where we've got sexual assaults, and they came out and said, well, there's a statute of limitations issue. So when you've got women that are sitting at home having to read on paper that their local prosecutors aren't going to take measures against an officer that has sexually assaulted them, then I think all of us have to sit here and question whether or not these policies and procedure changes and, you know, these reforms are actually doing what they're supposed to be doing. And right now there is zero evidence other than the DOJ's courage that these officers committing crimes are going to be treated just like criminals who are out there committing crimes. And you know, I think Tamika could probably speak more to this, but to have to go through so much work just to have some of the officers charged. I mean, there haven't even been convictions yet. There's been one guilty plea. That's not how this is supposed to be. And so today's a big day, but at the same time, we're reading recommendations. We got to see it get put into motion. What do you think, Tamika?
Absolutely. I mean, like you already said, we're still going back and forth with some of the things that we got in the settlement. So it's easy to say it until we actually start using those policies and procedures. It'll just keep repeating itself.
Mom, we know that the whole civil investigation that took place was about patterns and practices, but 502 Livestreamers asked the Attorney General the question, will the police officers responsible for the murder of Breonna Taylor be held accountable? And I'd like to know from the attorneys if there is any prospect of prosecutorial options against the police officers still who have not been named in recent indictments to have action taken.
I don't think that under federal statutes that other officers are going to be indicted anytime in the near future. But there's still state prosecutors who could do what they're supposed to do, state and local prosecutors who can do what they want to. The criminal standard at a federal level is much higher than that at the state level. And so that's one of the reasons why it's going to be harder at that federal level. But some of those protections from the federal level are not there at the state level. And so we have a Commonwealth attorney and an attorney general who, in my opinion, continue to not do their jobs.
And follow-up question, will any action be taken against Daniel Cameron for the lack of presentation of evidence in the grand jury that would have resulted in some of those indictments?
I mean, I think that's up to voters. He's running to be governor of Kentucky, so it's going to be up to the voters of Kentucky.
So you guys are essentially saying you don't think that all of the bad apples are, so to speak, are gone with regards to these two cases, related to these two cases?
Well, you know, I think that one of the things that speaks volumes is that when you look at Tayon's situation, we heard a lot today about Vice and then Ninth Mobile and then Criminal Interdiction Division. And then we look at Tamika Palmer's situation. We look at officers that had been on Ninth Mobile, then went into criminal interdiction. And so I think that we had a Department of Justice today that came down, especially when you start looking at their reports and the warrants and everything, that they have pinpointed a sector within LMPD that is responsible for a lot of problems. And it's these plainclothes, unchecked officers that don't activate their body cameras, that go out, mishandle confidential informants. Brian Bailey was Criminal Interdiction Division, so I'd really like to see LMPD step up and say, wow, is it a coincidence that we've got this unit right here that is responsible for so many problems? Or is this something that we need to gut and start over with? And the problem that we saw today, too, is that literally within this report, they indicated that the most documented citizen complaints that they could find over the last 5 years was 51 in a year. Now, let's face it. Do we think that during the protests and everything else that there were only 51 citizens that made any sort of informal complaints to LMPD? I'd venture to guess that there was more than 10 or 20 in a single day. And if you don't have a system of being able to document these complaints, make them part of an individual's file, investigate them, hold them accountable, then these officers think that they can operate each day with the full protection of those that are supervising them. So the first thing that LMPD needs to do, and they need to do it now, is they need to get civilians in there. If they can't find more officers, I'm sure that they can find civilians that are going to process these complaints, that are going to make sure that they are systematically investigated, and that officers are held accountable, because all of us should be able to call the police if we have problems with an officer and make sure that it's going to be thoroughly investigated. Because it's scary, Stefan, to think about how many of these could have been sexual assault, excessive force, search warrants that, you know, that shouldn't have been conducted, theft, whatever it is, that involved officers that went on to continue to do it over and over and over again with no documented history of ever doing it in the past. And that's scary.
What's the status of Tayon's case?
Well, Tayon's case is actually referenced within the report, not by name, but you'll see where a federal judge ruled in 2022 that a traffic stop was prolonged, that it was unlawful, there was a violation of the Fourth Amendment. That was Tayon's case. You know, we had a judge in the Western District who came down and said that, you know, their tactics of bringing over a canine, making him stand on the side of the road with handcuffs, patting him down when it was clear as day, you know, and frisking him when it was clear as day that he had no weapons on him, that it was unlawful as a matter of law. Now, it's still scheduled to go to a jury trial to, you know, assess what the damages are and what that's worth, but the judge has already ruled, you know, in our favor legally. Thankfully, that officer was part of that unit that was doing this 30 times a day. He's gone, but he still wears a badge, and they still closed his investigation by exception, so there's no record of him actually committing any sort of misconduct, and he's over the bridge, you know, policing over in Jeffersonville. But the we had the judge get it right on that one.
Ms. Palmer, with this coming so close to the 3-year date since your daughter was killed, how would you like people to remember her this coming Monday? And what does it mean to have, I guess, this information, you know, this report cut out at this time?
I don't even know what to say to that. I don't even know what to think, to know that this thing shouldn't have never happened, and that it took 3 years for anybody else to say that it shouldn't have.
When you hear her name on the national news or talk shows, Michael Eric Dyson included a chapter in his latest book about Breonna, and her name is said just like you would say any other well-known person. Does that give you any comfort just in terms of keeping her name alive and change that's happened around the country?
It goes to say I've always knew she would be great, that she would do good things. It shouldn't have took this.
And I go back to the beginning when Tamika always said, like, if one thing that the only positive thing that could come from losing her daughter is that she prevents other people from that same fate. And I think that today is indicative of that. I think when the officers that have been indicted were indicted, that's indicative of that. But only when we see true change, I think at the end of the day, this report solidified what Tamika knew, is that she should be able to pick up the phone today and call Breonna and talk to Breonna.